Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee in session five. I'd like to remind members and the public to turn off their mobile phones, and any members using electronic devices to access committee papers should please ensure that they are turned to silent. Today we continue to take evidence on the implications of the EU referendum result for Scotland. And I'd like to welcome our witnesses today to the meeting, Professor David Heald, Professor of Public Sector Accounting at the University of Glasgow, and Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics at the University of Stirling. Welcome and thank you for coming to give evidence to us today. I'd like to begin by inviting Professor Bell to make an opening statement.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee. I have been taking an interest in the last week or two around the EU budget, what might happen after Brexit. So where I would start is by saying that although the UK is a net contributor to the EU budget, a fair amount of money does come back to the UK, and a large proportion of that is what I would call area-based. In other words, it's tied to specific parts of the country. And the main elements of that are things like the agricultural payments and also the European Regional Development Fund and the European Social Fund. The amounts that are received are determined by different rules. So post-Brexit, one question will be whether to retain these mechanisms, and there are arguments for and against retaining these mechanisms. So some argue that we should go down the New Zealand route as far as agriculture is concerned and effectively not protect our agriculture industry at all. Equally, others argue that the structural funds have not been effective in achieving the objectives that they were intended to achieve, and that the case for retaining them is not strong. So that argument is out there. Let's suppose that they are retained in some form or other, then a number of decisions, it seems to me, have to be made. First of all, who sets and how the kind of quantum for each of the policies? So would we expect to spend the same amount of money on support for agriculture as we have in the past? And it's not entirely clear whether the amount of money that goes to the different funds is appropriate for the objectives that they set themselves. Having set the amount of money, then the question is, how is it divided? How would it be divided between the four nations? And at the moment, for example, in terms of the cap, the rule that was applied to the most recent budget round was simply to keep the same proportions as we had in the previous budget round. So it wasn't really looking at anything objective about the state of the agriculture industry in different parts of the UK. Rather, it was a line of least resistance, just do the same as you did before. So there's a question about doing that, because, of course, actually, the EU allocates its other form of area-based funding, the ERDF and the ESF, around quite strict criteria, namely the 75% of average EU GDP and the gap between 75 and 90% qualify in different ways for the ERDF and ESF funding. The UK has nothing quite so objective at the moment in terms of rules about allocating money to different parts of the country. Then once a decision is reached about that allocation, some possibilities are open, like actually passing the money through the Barnett formula, or allowing the different devolved assemblies and parliament to retain more tax revenue, or to have some objective metric which determines how much each part of the UK gets. And remember that in terms of the objective metric, what has happened in the last 20 years or so is actually Scotland has done relative, well, its economy has outperformed that of other parts of the UK, and now it's only West Wales and Cornwall that qualify for the highest levels of support, whereas in the past the Highlands did qualify under the previous rules. And then finally, if the money is divided, who sets the rules about how it's going to be distributed? And the European, the EU has worked with the devolved assemblies and parliament in some instances effectively to determine who gets what. Scotland has gone its own way in terms of agriculture policy and so on. So in the past, the devolved administrations have had considerable sovereignty as far as the administration and general running of the funding, which has come and is area-based. So there are my basic conclusion is that there are lots of decisions that have to be made, and they will it will be very important to understand how the different levels of government within the UK are negotiating these change in responsibilities, because there will be lots of opportunities for conflict.
Okay. Thank you very much. As you have indicated, Scotland has punched above its weight in terms of the allocation of EU funding that comes here. And I know that from our spice briefing, which is very useful, we get 44% of the fisheries funding, 18% of CAP Pillar 2, 16% of Pillar 1, 8% structural funds, which is equivalent to our population. So overall, they calculate that Scotland gets 14% of the UK's EU funding, which is obviously considerably above our population level in UK. I mean, could I ask what you think the likelihood is of us getting that 14, the equivalent of that 14% back? And if so, how will it be delivered?
I think the critical issue is that whatever gets repatriated from the European Union, one's got to think about the relationship between repatriated functions and how those repatriated functions are financed. I mean, if you look at the public expenditure statistical analysis on a per capita basis, the index for Scotland is about three times the index for England. So there's very significantly higher expenditure in Scotland on agriculture, fisheries and forestry than the UK average, and particularly than in England. And that given the fact that the money that the UK will not be sending to Brussels will stick in the Treasury, the question then becomes that if Scotland is going to get the functions that previously have been run by Europe, the question is, how does Scotland get the money to finance those functions? And that seems to be the critical central issue.
And obviously you have observed the way the Treasury operates fiscally for many, many years in terms of its relationship with Scotland. So in terms of your experience and expertise, what do you think the likelihood is of these funds being repatriated by the Treasury?
I think one's in such strange times that I think any kind of forecast is completely perilous. On balance, I think the Treasury's run the Barnett formula fairly honestly. There have been specific issues about the Carter Commission on prisons and the Olympics, but broadly the system has run on an informal non-statutory basis, and the Treasury has largely kept the rules, and that's been enormously beneficial to the Parliament in terms of its own discretion about its budget. But we're now getting into very kind of deep politics about that. Basically, the whole of the agricultural sector policy was really set at the European Union level. So what one was talking about in the UK was actually delivery, and delivery was largely done by the devolved administrations for the devolved areas and by the UK government for England. Now, the question is going to be whether the UK government now decides you're going to have a common policy for the UK single market in agriculture, as in other things. So I think it is a very big question about what the attitude will be. And that's separate from David Bell's point that there's going to be, I suspect, big arguments about the nature of the British economy after Brexit. David mentioned the issue of New Zealand in the 1980s and the removal of agricultural subsidies. There are some people on the Leave side were actually arguing for that in the run-up to the referendum. So I think that all the bets are off in terms of what policy looks like.
Yeah. But many people on the Leave side also said that Scotland would get full control of its automatic control of these EU competencies, agriculture, fisheries and environment.
Delve too deeply into the politics. People said an awful lot of things during the referendum that were fairly reprehensible.
Professor Bell, did you want to come back in again? A number of members want to ask questions.
All I would say is that on things like fishing and farming, amounts per head of the whole population aren't all that necessarily useful. These kinds of comparisons. Scotland just does more farming because there's lots more. It has lots more area, and it also does more fishing because it has abundant seas nearby. It is the case, however, therefore, that if these arguments prevail about reducing agricultural support overall, or reducing the kinds of support provided by ERDF and ESF, well, Scotland will be particularly exposed in relation to farming, less exposed in relation to the RDF and ESF, because, as you say, its proportion relative to its population in that respect isn't that much different. It's not much different from its population share.
Okay, thank you. Tavish Scott, and then Richard Lockhead.
Thank you very much, Convener. David Bell, can I thank you for your paper on agriculture to begin with? It was really useful yesterday to read that. If you were advising two people, one of which would be the National Farmers Union of Scotland, and on the other hand, the Scottish Government, what would it be in terms of the best funding formula to achieve the current £400 million we currently spend on Scottish agriculture, putting aside all the policy issues about whether you believe in freedom to farm or supporting crofters or whatever it might be? If you just go with the money, how would you best deliver what we currently get in Scotland from whatever's going to happen in the future?
Well, I think agriculture's in a particularly difficult position. This is partly because, as I pointed out, it's dependent on EU capped subsidies for between a third and a half of its income. Mm. So if that was to disappear, we would have very significant restructuring of the agriculture sector in Scotland, and clearly that would be difficult for many communities. It's also true that its main markets, its main export markets, are in Europe rather than in the States or Australia or wherever. And therefore, if it wants to compete on an even footing with European farmers, then if CAP subsidies are reduced, then inevitably that will tend to force it into driving up prices, which means it will lose competitive advantage with European producers. On the other hand, it will then, if the UK goes into deals with third countries like Canada or Australia or wherever, they will be putting on pressure to reduce tariffs and income support for farmers. And, agriculture is probably the most contested area of all in terms of how it operates how agricultural trade between countries operates. The WTO has laboured long and hard to try to reduce tariffs, reduce levels of protection for agriculture, and not all that. It hasn't been all that successful in so doing. And there are very significant tariffs, as I showed in my paper, which protect European agriculture. You know, some are as high as 80% at the moment. So I think this is difficult. My advice to the NFU would be to try to retain as much of the status quo as possible, because that would mean retaining income, but also not being at a competitive disadvantage to the European market, which is their main market. So whether that will be feasible, of course, that, you know, in the negotiations with the European Union, they may insist that that doesn't happen. You know, they could look at the tariff barriers in relation to agricultural products that might hit some of their own trade, but you know, there's a trade-off clearly going on between politics and economics in Europe, just as much as there's a trade-off going on between politics and economics in the UK.
That's helpful. You'd accept that Barnett is never going to be the way to achieve that objective in terms of spending to Northern Ireland, Wales and Scotland on agriculture. We just go down on that. By any objective measure, we would go down compared to what we currently get for agricultural spending in Scotland.
But it depends what we mean by Barnett. What happened? No, but Barnett has got more and more complicated over time. It started off being really quite simple, but if we take the example of railways,
can we stick with agriculture? I'm not interested in railways.
No, if I could please finish my point. When the Scottish Parliament got responsibility for agriculture, what there was a block transfer. Mm. So the existing spending on rail in Scotland was moved into the block. So the actual existing spending was transferred in, and then Barnett applied to increments. The obvious problem about that is, given all the uncertainties, it's going to put farmers in competition with nurses when it comes to spending priorities. Mm-hmm. But say it isn't. You can't just say that Barnettizing it means that you only get the population proportion. What would actually happen on past precedent would be moving the existing spend into the Barnett formula, into the block, and then using Barnett according to the fiscal framework for subsequent changes. The problem is that agriculture, because of all the uncertainties we're talking about, is actually really quite unpredictable.
And therefore, there's an argument for not putting it into Barnett and keeping it as a separate transfer to the devolved.
You have to think about the kind of broader policy position. I mean, I started my comments by making the point that you needed to think about the relationship between taking on the functions and getting the finance, because no contributions to the European Union, not making them, sticks as a benefit to the Treasury. So you've got the question about who has policy control. You can think of all sorts of arrangements whereby the UK government had control of agriculture, fisheries and food in a policy framework sense, but actually delivery was done by the devolved administrations and by DEFRA for England. So there are all sorts of variants. For example, it could be put into annually managed expenditure outside Barnett. So there's all sorts of possible possible arrangements. My attitude, I've been arguing for devolutions for 40 years now, and I've got a track record of wanting to take as many functions as one can get. But I think this is kind of territory you have to think about very carefully. So I would only recommend taking on policy control of agriculture if the financial arrangements actually come at the same time. I think having policy control over agriculture without actually securing the financial arrangements could actually be quite dangerous.
But policy control in London would be a reverse of devolution.
Policy control would be a reverse of devolution in that particular context. But we live in strange times.
Yeah, OK. Politics of that.
Thank you. In that previous discussion, there's an assumption that there's a relationship between the share of the budget post-Brexit and policy. But is it not the case that the UK government can simply divorce policy from the share of the budget that's allocated to Scotland in terms of agriculture? So they could say, OK, 14% has come from Europe whilst we're a member of the European Union, but now we're out of the European Union, you're just getting your population share irrespective of your budget because agriculture's devolved, therefore you just take the money and do what you want with it. But there's no relationship between policy and the share of the budget, therefore the UK government can reduce dramatically the amount of money that goes towards agriculture.
I don't think that chimes with what's happened in terms of the transfer of functions over time. So, for example, you know, effectively, the Barnett formula has been adjusted downwards or by the exact amount of tax being raised for the new tax powers. And it's been increased by... It tends to operate on precedent rather than on the current population share. So, I agree with what David said previously, that if agriculture was put into the Barnett formula, and currently 600 million or so is spent in on the CAP in Scotland, then the Barnett allocation to Scotland would increase by 600 million. And then in the following years, any changes that happened in relation to spending on agriculture in England, so if they go up by 2%, then there would implicitly be a 2% added to the 600 million for Scotland. It seems to me the problem is more that agriculture is a much less important... Well, it isn't all that huge an important issue for the Scottish economy. It is less than 1% of Scotland's GDP, but it is even smaller in relation to England's GDP, and they may take the view that, well, this doesn't matter so much. So you end up in the situation where if the money going to agriculture isn't increasing, but there are reasons in England, but there are reasons for trying to increase the amount of money going to agriculture in Scotland, then you are raiding other budgets in Scotland to make that happen.
Yeah. I mean, agriculture, of course, underpins the food and drink sector, which is a much larger share of GNP in Scotland. The issue, though, is that the UK government could take a decision that it does not want to support agriculture, therefore that would impact negatively on the Scottish budget, irrespective of the policy adopted in Scotland.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, the whole point, the whole fiscal framework since devolution in 1999 has been non-statutory. I mean, it's been basically done, as I said earlier, relatively consensually. There have been arguments about specific points, but basically the precedent has been followed. But the kind of policy risk will be if the UK, if you had separate policy control in the four jurisdictions, and the UK government decided it was going to go down a very free market line and not support agriculture, and the Scottish government decided it wanted to continue to support agriculture, one's going to get a high budgetary cost.
Could I just add on that point too that. There is the clash of local control over agriculture and the role that agriculture plays in trade negotiations, so that if trade negotiations with the USA involve arguments that direct payments to farmers should be reduced or eliminated because they don't exist in the States, so US farmers are going to say, this is not a fair competition. You reduce your direct payments to farmers, then that will have an effect on what can be done locally in terms of developing policy for agriculture in Scotland.
Okay. My final question just relates to transparency. Clearly, going forward, the public in Scotland, Parliament will want to know what the UK was paying into Europe, what's coming back from Europe, and then whether Scotland gets its fair share thereafter, post-Brexit. My experience of some of these issues is there's a lot of smoke and mirrors. What are your comments on how easy it will be for Scotland to hold the UK government to account in terms of these figures?
I think it's going to be quite tricky. You may not know, but actually some local authorities in England took the UK government to court because they argued in terms, I think it was the ERDF allocations to different parts of the UK. Their argument was that Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland were getting too much and that the EU's intention had been to provide more funding to the north of England than it had received. That failed in court, that their argument failed. But that's, you know, just an illustration of the kind of the arbitrary nature or informal nature or smoke and mirrors nature of what currently goes on. So, the existing frameworks don't fill me with confidence that people are going to be happy about the nature of the information they're receiving and their understanding of the process whereby big sums of money are allocated to different parts of the UK, and there is a need to open that up.
I know much less about the detail of agriculture than many people in the room. One of the things that I found very helpful was the spice briefing that came with the committee papers. I think that when it comes to the agricultural support, it's obviously relatively clear what's coming into the Scottish budget. But other European payments have obviously been coming into other parts of the Scottish economy. I'm not in a position to know how transparent those are.
Thanks. Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much. Can I move the focus a little further onto the structural funding side of things, because I think there are some important issues here. First of all, David Bell, in your introduction, said that there's an argument that it's difficult to identify evidence from the evidence that structural funds have achieved their objective. I suppose the one case that might be offered against that in the Scottish context would be the Highlands and Islands, where a combination of the efforts of Highlands and Islands Enterprise and the use of those European funds has actually removed the Highlands and Islands from the bottom end of the European scale into somewhere nearer the middle. I wonder, first of all, if you think that there is, that the case around structural funds is one that will of itself be contentious. And secondly, again, given the North of England example you quoted, is it in the interest of those areas of Scotland that benefit from structural funds at the moment for them to be measured objectively on criteria that apply across the UK, or is it more likely to be advantageous if there's an allocation post-2020 that would then be addressed within Scotland alone?
Yeah, so I could say a few things about that. Firstly, these, I think I, as a Highlander, probably agree with you that the EU has had a significant effect on the Highland economy. Most of the evaluations that have been done, though, are Europe-wide. Some have been UK-wide, and there are certain pockets of the European economy in particular that seem to be resistant to improvement. So you get Portugal, some parts of Spain, some parts of Italy, and so on. So maybe that's been an important context for these views that the structural funds have not achieved their objectives. And of course, what are their objectives is a further question. Probably the one that most people would accept is the cohesion argument, the need to reduce spatial inequalities across the EU. Now, others have argued that the structural funds are a important generators of overall national economic growth. And that argument has been contested hotly in recent years by some who argue, well, it's actually these area-based funds are not that useful, that concentrating your money in cities, because you get there what are called agglomeration economies, is a more effective way to enhance national growth. And as a result, I think you can see a clear line of that thinking into some of the policies that the UK government is following. The cities approach, Northern Powerhouse, effectively is not an area, it is focused on particular cities. And so, you know, if that is part of the background thinking of the UK government and the Treasury, then their willingness to support broad areas, you know, to provide money to broad areas, they may think that that is money not well spent, better to improve the infrastructure and skills, but concentrate that improvement on cities or agglomerations of cities. I'm certainly in principle in favour of using objective criteria to determine who gets the money. I think once you get into effectively what end up being negotiations between local authorities and the government, whether it's the Scottish government or the UK government, and then you provide support to that initiative, you know, one of these city initiatives, it becomes very, very difficult to understand why they've got it against somebody, some other potential candidate, and it becomes difficult to evaluate it. At the end of the day, what were his objectives? What would have happened if that money had not been given? So, you know, at the end of the day, if you're implementing policy, you want to be able to evaluate it and to determine whether it's a success or not a success. Therefore, you know, you would put more money into the successful ones and not into the unsuccessful ones.
So looking forward, there's no certainty. I think I would deduce from that answer. There's no certainty either the UK government or potentially a future Scottish government would accept the current model of on which structural funding is based. Can I ask about the short-term aspect of structural funding? At the moment, I think between now and 2020, the amount of money committed is less than half, or just about half, of that that's allocated to Scotland. And within that half, an even smaller proportion has actually been spent. So there's a couple of questions I'd be interested in your views on. First of all, whether in these circumstances there is a guarantee that we can be confident that further 400 million that's not yet arrived will arrive under the UK government's guarantee that's been given on structural funding. And secondly, what the implications are for public bodies, local authorities and others, universities and so on in Scotland, that have to raise match funding in order for those that spending to go ahead. So, and the context being, if there is a real difficulty in delivering the existing structures before Brexit, the implications of that going forward are significant as well.
My expectation is that nothing will change very quickly. I mean, I think that the on the whole, I would trust the UK government to fulfil its guarantees about what's going to happen until 1920. But the issue is going to be probably one of whether people lose heart about applying for European funds, given that all the talk is about Brexit, and particularly the issue about finding the matching funding. The UK is now in a position whereby, and if one looks at the IFS green budget that got released early in the week, we're talking about a period of about 15 years, three parliaments of fiscal austerity. Now, that is unprecedented in the last 100 years. So there's going to be intense pressure on all public spending. And one's seeing kind of manifestations of that in terms of crisis about the NHS in England. So I think there's going to be a period of intense pressure, and I think that there may well be an issue of persuading people, both of releasing the match funding and persuading people that it is worth the effort at committing the effort, which of course is very resource intensive, with a very substantial degree of uncertainty about what's going to happen. But on balance, as in the kind of earlier discussion about the Barnett formula, on the whole, the Treasury thus far has played the game fairly straight. But as I said earlier, we're in very strange times.
Is that your view as well?
Yes, broadly, I would agree, particularly about expectations and how people change their behaviour, and particularly in the run up to 2020, and there are somewhat worrying signs in the scientific community, I think, about what the role of UK academics might be in future European projects.
Just as a couple of very brief supplementaries to that, in terms of the match funding, these structural funds are in euros. With the situation with the fall in sterling, does that put extra pressure on organisations who may be considering match funding? Because I understand the value of these structural funds has increased because sterling has fallen.
Yeah, I mean, it means that there's more purchasing power from the European funding, but the match funding is higher.
Yes. Yes. Okay, thanks. And my second supplementary is in terms of this committee is quite unusual in that we have three South of Scotland MSPs represented on it, completely randomly. There was a plan in the South of Scotland, which was quite well developed by local authorities and the government, to create a new statistical European area under NUTS 2, which would presumably, the motivation for that was that eventually it would be in a good position to obtain additional structural funds. Where would that plan be now? I don't know if you're aware of it. You think it's underwater?
I think there have been various rejigging of the boundaries in different parts of the UK over the years. I suspect that the UK government will not feel constrained by European statistical conventions, which is worrying in itself, actually, but in particular in relation to the way that any area-based funding might be distributed in the future. It may go for something that more relates to the structure of government in different parts of the country. That might be local authorities or combinations of local authorities. So I don't imagine that the NUTS conventions will survive Brexit for too long. Well, I'd be surprised.
There is a kind of broader issue that one of the ways in which the UK government is kept honest is the fact that Eurostat, the European Union Statistical Agency, actually monitors the UK practices in terms of national accounts and in terms of general government finances, particularly in the context of the excessive deficits procedure. You don't have to be a member of the European Union to actually follow ESA 2010, but it's probably the case that Eurostat takes less interest in the countries that follow ESA 10, but which are not actually part of the European Union. And one of the things that I've been conscious over the time is that the Treasury from time to time puts pressure on the Office for National Statistics about classification decisions. And if I was running the Office for National Statistics, one of the things I would always say to the Treasury was, you might press us, but you've also got to get that past Eurostat. And when Eurostat is no longer relevant or no longer as highly relevant, I would think we may have some significant difficulties on the statistical side.
Can I just one more question on the question of structural funds? Because in responding to earlier questions, you made the point that agriculture is something that will come into trade negotiations, and therefore the UK government will have a very direct interest in issues, for example, such as income support. Structural funding, the decision to support under our less developed regions or alternatively city regions, is there such a conflict? Is there an international or an external aspect of that that would be affected in the same way?
You're coming close, but I don't think quite impacting on issues like state aid and public procurement rules, which almost inevitably form part of trade negotiations. But things like the ESF and the ERDF tend to be a step back in terms of them being infrastructure support or general support for skills. There's a certain amount of ERDF funding, I think, goes into SMEs, but I don't think trade negotiations worry that much about SMEs. It's a country providing a big chunk of money to, say, a car company, which then subsidises it effectively to compete with the country that you're trying to do the trade deal with. That's the sort of thing that really does matter in trade negotiation.
Yeah. So not directly in this?
No, I don't think so.
Ross Greer.
Convener, this was actually quite substantially covered in your answers to Lewis McDonald's point, but to move on the point around the structural funding and the need to match fund, as has been mentioned, there's around £400 million that needs match funded over the next few years. Our public finances in Scotland are now much more directly tied to the performance of the Scottish economy, and we would expect that Brexit will have an impact on the Scottish economy in the next 2 years, i.e. before the point of Brexit actually happening itself. What would you expect the Scottish Government to be doing about that?
Well, so the way that the impact happens is through differences in per capita tax revenues. So if we fall behind in terms of our the amount of money that the average income taxpayer in Scotland pays into HMRC compared with the equivalent south of the border. And that's what will determine what's called the block grant adjustment, which is the thing, which is where this kind of issue of the relative performance of the Scottish economy matters. Now, if Brexit pulls the whole British economy down, then actually there won't be much effect on Scotland's funding as such, because the block grant adjustment will fall, which means less will be taken out of the Scottish budget. So the question is, will Scotland do differentially badly for whatever reason? And obviously, in the last 2-3 years, we've seen Scotland do differentially badly, I think, largely because of the oil industry, which is a shock that's hit Scotland more than it's hit the rest of the UK. So my guess is that in the period up to 2020, our finances will be very constrained, as David has indicated, but we won't do massively differentially badly compared to the rest of the UK, because the income tax per head may be falling in both parts of the country. It is a problem for the match funds, though, because these are amounts that have already been set and their value has increased. The same issue, though, it certainly does apply in England, and it's going to apply even more in Wales, which gets far more per head in terms of support from ERDF and ESF than Scotland does. I don't know what action the Welsh Government is going to take in that respect. But I guess what I'm saying is that the situation is bad, but it's not catastrophic.
If I could just add to that, although I agree with David's emphasis on the differential between per capita tax revenues in England and Scotland, there is also the absolute effect that if the economy does worse, we're more likely to get spending. We're more likely to get more spending cuts passed through the Barnett formula. I mean, one of the striking things about the IFS green budget this week was the fact that by 2019-20, the UK ratio of tax to GDP is forecast to be the highest since 1986-87. So the IFS is talking about further public spending cuts or further fiscal adjustment of 40 billion. So that it's the differential Scotland-England matters, but if Brexit has a very bad effect on the UK economy as a whole, there's going to be more fiscal adjustment at the UK level, which will then feed through to the Scottish budget.
Thanks. And just very briefly, if that's okay. There was a question posed to the Scottish Government at FMQs a few weeks ago, and as is the nature of FMQs, it was posed on the spot, so you don't necessarily expect a comprehensive answer at that moment, but it was around what forecasting they should be doing on the impact on our public finances. If you were in that position, what forecasting would you be doing for both that short-term period of the next 2 to 3 years and the 5 to 10 that come after Brexit?
I'm not sure I would be... Forecasting, because as David says, we live in very unusual times, and the past isn't necessarily a good information basis on which now to project the future. But what I would be trying to do is to get some information on these issues that do seem critical to me that we've already been discussed, like how are the structural funds going to continue? Is agricultural support going to continue? How is it going to be organised? And how is it going to be funded? That, you know, that's the first set of questions. Then the next set of questions, I would be going through the Scottish economy sector by sector and saying, well, let's assume that we do enter into trade negotiations with country X. What will be their strengths? What will they be expecting from the bargaining situation? Because it will be give and take. The UK will not get just what it wants. And how I think, you know, going through the Scottish economy sector by sector would be an important exercise to be thinking about in the relatively short term.
Thank you.
Jackson Carlo.
Thank you, Convener. I almost think maybe I should have come in slightly earlier because I'm coming back to a point, although you've touched on it again. And I think it was in a discussion with Tavish Scott where you were saying, you know, that there wouldn't be a retrospective application of Barnett, but the precedent would suggest that there would be existing funding transferred. But that if the Barnett formula was the mechanism that was used going forward in relation to agriculture, it would actually be a progressive reduction in the overall support. Although, of course, the Barnett formula is highly valued in respect of other sectors in relation to Scotland. So I suppose, and you then, I think, to Roscrea said this is one of the areas that would need to be thrashed out and agreed. I suppose I'm interested to know what you think, if the situation as you described it happened, the precedent is applied, the sum comes, is transferred across, what would be the funding formula this committee should be looking to try and advocate going forward that would protect the sector if it was to be progress on sort of the current basis. And I suppose the second incidental question, and it's really just one about which I don't know, and you've referred to New Zealand several times in passing. What happened to the New Zealand agriculture sector in the years subsequent to the removal of the support that was previously there?
As I say, I'm not a specialist in the field. My understanding is that New Zealand did exceptionally well after the... But obviously, it's an economy in which agriculture is enormously important and it's got lots of sheep. The question about... to come back to my own kind of area of expertise, I think before I was explaining how you could Barnettize it... But I think before you think about the financial arrangements, you have to think about what the UK government intends in the form of policy control. So there's a kind of, you know, there's a long spectrum between going for a free market in agricultural products and broadly continuing the present level of spending on agricultural subsidy. So until one knows whereabouts on the spectrum that is, and then there becomes the question of to what extent the devolved administrations will get legislative control and to what extent they would continue to have a delivery responsibility. But yes, I mean, if the UK government wants a smaller public sector, it's obvious that all parts of the public sector, all parts of public spending, are going to have a very difficult future. And one of the significant problems the UK economy's got, that many other economies have got, is that tax revenues have done very badly since the 2008 global recession. So it's not just a question of what the government has done on tax. It's the fact that the recovery has been pretty weak and it's not been very tax rich, and there are complicated factors behind why the economy hasn't been very tax rich, and so that all parts of the public sector face a very difficult future.
Speaking from my agricultural background as a potato inspector, the New Zealand economy, the agriculture sector, has done very well. Of course, it had to restructure a lot.
Exactly.
And in addition, it's not close neighbours, but it's the economy that has thrived. The East Asian economy in the last 20 years or so had a huge demand for food, changed its eating habits quite a lot, and that has been another part of the success of New Zealand. It's not obvious that Scotland would have such opportunities.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton. Supplementary on Ross's question, actually. It's clear that we need to have a strong economy to go forward. However, do you think it would be foolhardy to create a separate Scottish system for CAP and within the other devolved administrations as well, considering that Scotland agriculture exports are 85% within the domestic market? I just wondered if creating barriers within and a separate system would then create barriers to that would inhibit that important market which Scottish agriculture relies on?
So at the moment, the main element of CAP is the direct payment to farmers, which is not related to output. So I guess what you've got to think about is this an appropriate way to remunerate farmers? What is it that you want farmers to do? What do you want farmers not to do? I guess you don't want them to damage the environment. You do want them to help to sustain rural communities, probably help to sustain ecological diversity, that sort of thing. So I would take that as the first principles, actually, that I would be looking at when thinking about how to support agriculture. The existing system, which is basically a direct payment for the number of acres you've got, serves mainly to increase the price of land, and it also makes it more difficult for new entrants into farming to get in there, because the capital cost that they face is that much higher. And farmers are in general old, so I would if designing my own equivalent of the common agricultural policy, I would think very carefully about what it is that farmers do, and try to provide them with incentives to do the kinds of things that we want them to do. I suspect then you end up with a restructuring of the industry that will end up, if they are to survive, then they have to be competitive. They will reorganise themselves into the kinds of structures that will continue to allow them to compete in domestic markets.
I think one of the things that is very striking, is that agricultural policy hasn't worked particularly well. There's a very critical Audit for Scotland report from last year, and there's equally a very critical report from the European Court of Auditors. So they're very big problems, both about policy, about objectives, about implementation, about enforcement. And you know, I don't know enough about the sector to have developed policy views on what to do.
Can I have 86% of the farming land is classified as a less favoured area. 86% of the farming land in Scotland is classified as less favoured area. Now, the Scottish Government have continued payments for less favoured areas. Do you think if there was a UK-wide approach that less favoured area status would continue, given that it has been phased out in England currently?
I'm not an expert, but I have seen these Scottish Government documents which indicate that the payments per acre in Scotland are way lower than in other parts of the EU, and just the way the overall monies coming to the UK have changed through time and the way that different areas are classified. If you start with a blank slate, I suspect that you wouldn't go down this particular route. But as I said in my last answer, I think, you know, this is an opportunity in a sense for the UK as a whole, and maybe Scotland, for good reason, is able to set its own policy because the circumstances in Scotland are for farming are quite different.
Yeah, I wanted to just press you on that because, you know, like that's a big figure, 86% of the land less favoured. So clearly there are different priorities for agriculture in Scotland and in England.
Yeah, well, that's true. I mean, I would take them to a kind of the next level. What exactly is it? Is it to keep rural communities able to continue? Is it to protect Scotland's scenery? Is it to protect biodiversity? These sorts of things. So I would start at that level and then go down from that to discuss, well, some of the land should be classified as, because there's lots of less, you know, there are lots of Scotland that isn't that productive per acre. So you have to have some system if you are going to support at the kind of aerial level, you have to have some way of dealing with that. So I guess what I'm saying is that Scotland may be being disadvantaged at the moment, but this is an opportunity now to think very carefully about what the whole system is trying to provide.
Economists of a free market disposition might be inclined to reply to your question by saying that agriculture should stop in those areas. There's very big social and economic issues clearly Scotland's a much bigger proportion of the UK landmass than it is in population terms. So there are very clearly big issues. And the issue, although it's not a large part of the Scottish economy, it's of great, much greater political significance.
Yeah, and I guess that's what I'm getting at. Not that, you know, that the system's perfect just now, as you've clearly said, the system's not perfect just now. There's an opportunity to create a better system. What I'm getting at is, where should that happen? I mean, we were reassured that agriculture would remain with Scotland after Brexit, and it would seem that Scotland would be the best place to design a new system for Scottish farming.
But what the Scottish Parliament have now got is actually the execution. The policy is actually Europe. So essentially, post-1999, what the Scottish Parliament got and the Scottish Government got was actually the execution of a system set at a higher level. Now, the big policy question is whether the policy in future is going to be set at the UK level or at the devolved level plus England. And as David Bell's already said, that's going to feed into trade negotiations, because one's going to have very significant, I suspect, arguments between potential trade partners in terms of state aids and subsidies. so that it's impossible. I find it impossible to believe that a significant part of the policy responsibility won't stay at the UK level because of the importance that people are attaching to trade negotiations. And there's going to be all sorts of things about trade negotiations. One of them is going to be about things like animal welfare, genetic crops, and so on. There's all sorts of things going to enter into those trade negotiations.
Okay. Emma Harper.
Actually, the first was what I was thinking, so that's fine. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Okay. In terms of trade negotiations, we've been repeatedly told that you can't, and it says more or less in David Bell's paper, that you can't have a free trade arrangement and subsidised farming. That only happens in the single market of the European Union.
Yeah. So, actually, I think that's not strictly true, but what it does illustrate that point is how strength in negotiations matter. I looked at a website that the Canadian farmers maintain, the Canadian equivalent of the NFU, and the CETA, I've forgotten what it actually stands for, but it's the trade deal that's been done recently between Europe and Canada, shows, I think the agreement brings down tariffs on food between Canada and Europe. But the EU, the big negotiator in those in that negotiation, has not agreed to cut the CAP. So it's not, you know, we'd certainly have heard if that was the case. So they're going to maintain payments to farmers, and they've said to the Canadians, yeah, we'll take our tariffs off, take it or leave it, you know? So the Canadian NFU, equivalent of, argued that, well, there isn't all that much in it for us, because although we're much more efficient producers, we'll be competing against wheat from, you know, wheat from Saskatchewan will be competing with wheat from Italy, where the farmers are getting these direct payments. So the question then is, will the UK be a strong party or a weak party in terms of the negotiations that it enters into? What will it be prepared to give up in order, for example, to get access to the other country's car market? And so this, you know, this is really why the Scottish government has to, in a way, to be in a position to understand what's going on.
Thank you. Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Convener. It's just a couple of questions. Certainly throughout the discussion this morning, there's been a few issues that have been raised, one of which obviously we've been discussing quite a lot about agriculture and public procurement was discussed, and in recent comments there regarding the CETA was brought into the discussion. Now, the CETA deal, that became more interesting and more something worth considering between the parties when provincial procurement became part of the considerations. Now, in terms of the UK's bargaining power of 65 million people against 440 and also against 318 in the US, does this then have that opportunity or that negative opportunity of actually opening up wider aspects of the public sector, including the NHS, when it comes to any trade and negotiations?
I doubt if the NHS will be included, but I think some of these issues probably will become part of the debate. So state aid is almost always part of trade negotiations. So if I'm an investor willing to invest in your country, I want to be sure that you will not subsidise a competitor that will drive me out of business and cause me to lose my investment. Public procurement also does tend to be involved in trade negotiations because access to, in some countries the state sector is a very large sector. And again, I will only invest in your country if I have free rein to tender both in the private and in the public sector. I think the negotiations with Europe are unlikely to go into the NHS because there's already a clear understanding of what state aid means and what public procurement means. But I think that if we do enter into a deal with the EU, hopefully we will, one shouldn't be surprised if the rules on state aid and the rules on public procurement don't change that much.
Okay. I think one of the things that concerns me on the transparency front is that one of the advantages of the Office for Budget Responsibility is it's within the government information perimeter, so it actually gets access to government information. And when it came round, when it came round to the autumn statement, the government refused to release to the treasury, refused to release to OBR the letter of comfort that had been given to Nissan. So I think that I suspect we're going to see a lot of guarantees and a lot of letters of comfort. What those letters of comfort say, and what the potential fiscal cost is in future, I'm concerned about. But I would have thought that other countries will be asking questions as well. Because a lot of what is now more upfront of state aid might actually start vanishing under the carpet.
Well, that then opens up, it could be argued, the issue of discussions between the devolved parliaments and assemblies and the UK government through the GMC in terms of what's actually, in terms of that issue of transparency. What's been fully discussed on the agenda and how effective these discussions actually are. Would that be a fair assumption?
I'm not sure that the UK government will be terribly concerned about the devolved administrations in this context. Given the fact that it was the Conservative government that set up the OBR in 2010, I think once hit a particular sensitive point when one starts denying information to institutions one set up oneself.
And my final question is just go back to the issue of when it comes to the trade negotiations anything will be on the table. The speech that the Prime Minister gave at Lancaster House, towards the end of her speech, there was a number of areas that were actually on there, one of which was on fishing. So for the UK to actually attempt to get some type of a trade deal, is it a legitimate issue to consider that fishing might be, once again, be considered to be a bargaining tool and a bargaining chip to get some type of deal to allow EU member states access to fishing waters in Scotland and the UK?
A trade deal is about all trade. And there's trade in fish, there's trade in agricultural products, there's trade in manufacturers and services. deal, it seems to me, could be quite... will probably cover in tortuous detail all aspects of potential trade between countries. I think there's also an issue of historic rights that predate the setting up of the EU as far as fishing is concerned. So these will have to be also dealt with as in the very large agreement, if it happens. It's not going to be a short one.
I mean, the only thing I would have to add is that I would have thought a significant part of the output of the Scottish fishing industry actually goes to Europe, judging by the Murray lorries that are obviously European. That's where a lot of the seafood is going. So the question of access to markets is going to be a very important one for the fishing industry outside the common fisheries policy.
Okay, thank you very much.
Supplementary from Ross Greer.
On Stuart Mellon's first point, mentioned the NHS and trade deal CETA, for example. My understanding of where difficulties often arise with trade deals is not in what's specifically included, but what is not specifically excluded. So, for example, the Scottish NHS is not specifically excluded from CETA. We're yet to see what the consequences of that might be. So there is an issue there in that the devolved parliaments and assemblies or governments of the UK don't have the ability to, they don't have a role within the UK's trade negotiations. Is that not where the risk then comes to our public services, where they've not been specifically excluded?
I don't have sufficient knowledge to comment.
No, I'm not sure. I mean, so with any of these deals, there always has to be an overarching body that arbitrates when there are disputes, maybe the, you know, in relation, for example, to Scottish NHS. This is why take back control is a bit of a problem, because any trade deal that you do with a third party, you will have to agree a form of arbitration to resolve any disputes that you may have. Now, in terms of just the number of disputes that are resolved, The European Court of Justice is just, I think, by a factor of at least 100, deals with more disputes than does the WTO. If I'm in the WTO and I want to object to, sorry, if I'm a country and want to object to another country's trade practices, and we are both members of the WTO, I have to raise that with my government. Then my government has to be willing to take it on. It has to. They have to engage with the other country's government. And it takes a long time. They don't deal with that many disputes. If you're in Europe, you as a company can raise a dispute because of another companies' practices in France or in Germany and so on. So you have a resolution mechanism. I think that is a... we haven't talked about it very much, but it is almost the most important... or one of the most fundamental aspects of any trade deal is your agreement with the other country about how you deal with disputes.
A very quick supplementary from Lewis.
Yeah, I would just want to follow up... what Stuart McMillan asked about fisheries, because the one thing we've not touched on today is the European Maritime Fisheries Fund, which is the one area payment which Scotland has the greatest benefit from. I think we've established from today's evidence that agriculture is bound to be drawn into trade deals, and therefore there will be an impact on agricultural subsidy. Structural funds are much less likely to be drawn into trade deals, and therefore they're much more can be determined autonomously here. Where does the fisheries fund fall in that spectrum? Is it likely to be is direct support for fisheries exports and also for the fisheries restructuring likely to be part of a trade deal, or is it likely to be domestically determined?
So the deal that Norway has done to gain access through the EEA to the single market specifically excludes fisheries and agriculture, I think. So that that approach is possible, that means you have less things to bargain with when you come to making the deal. So effectively, Norway has to accept what the EU does in respect of setting the rules around trading. It has to accept the free movement of people. It has to accept the free movement of capital and the free movement of services. Now, would it have got a different deal if it had put fisheries and agriculture into the pot? I'm not clear. Probably the EU thought this is a relatively small country and these issues don't matter all that much. it's not, you know, at the moment it's pretty unpredictable whether it all depends on the bargaining position that the UK government takes. But again, for the communities that are concerned about that issue, there's an argument that they should have an input to any debate around what's in, what's out.
Yeah, can I just finish off by pointing to page 9 of your paper, Professor Bell, where you say something that could suggest that a lot of our conversation today about the transfer of funds and so on is rather immaterial, because you suggest that the UK could choose to use the money that it saved to pay off the budget deficit. And you say that £8 billion would be what the UK would gain if it was no longer contributing to the EU budget, and there would be an argument to put that into the £59 billion budget deficit. How likely is that, do you think?
I think that that's less likely than before the referendum. Although, as David has pointed out, and the IFS has pointed out, the fiscal situation remains dire. I think the UK government, although it's not entirely clear, is taking the view that it wants to be seen to be benefiting all parts of the country, and probably there, I'm thinking of Northern England more than, you know, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. But one consequence of that may well be a retention of something like the structural funds and some form of agricultural payment, maybe a reduced one. In order to maintain this argument that the economy shouldn't be just run for the southeast of England.
Professor Heald?
I don't really have anything to add.
Right, OK. Well, thank you both for coming to see us today and giving your evidence. Thank you. We'll now suspend briefly to move into private session.